Stay close by my side. Keep your eyes on me. Though this life is hard, I will give. Trust me when I say that I will give you perfect peace, and you'll never walk alone, and you'll never be. Storms around you, you can hide in me. Burdens that you bear, offer no relief. I will give you perfect peace.
Let us begin in the name of the Father, the Son, of the Holy Spirit. Lord Jesus, tonight we offer this time to you. We offer this space to you. Allow us to have an heart of openness, a heart that is receptive of your love. Amen. In the name of Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Amen. Good evening, brothers and sisters in Christ. Welcome to the School of the Word. I'm Terence, one of the lead missionary disciples with Vermonde Singapore, and I'm here to share some reflections with you tonight. So as what Sister Leticia said, some of us who just joined, we are in the second part of this Advent series. So last week, we were invited to place our investments in places that will last, and Jesus is the hope that we can count on. As I went back to ponder a little more about how I'm going to invest more of my talents, my heart, and my time to Jesus, I couldn't help but notice that as much as I wanted to give them up for the Lord, I don't seem to be too comfortable in giving my everything. I would feel that something inside me is restless and resisting to give that last bit. But in prayer, one fruit that I received was that this is a first step of an ongoing journey towards a transformative relationship with Jesus. The transformation in the season of Advent doesn't just take place overnight, but over a season of smaller transformations each day. So tonight, I would like to invite us to continue to enter into this journey of allowing ourselves to be transformed by opening our hearts to Jesus, who is the Prince of Peace. So since you're on this journey towards Christmas, perhaps let's try to begin with the end in mind. By the time Christmas comes, how do you want to celebrate this feast of the birth of Jesus? Would it be whether we have successfully organized a Christmas party, or maybe we have bought all our Christmas gifts and give them all away to our friends and families? Or maybe whether we have managed to finish all our New Year resolutions from the start of the year, right, since the year is ending. And at this point, you may start to panic and look at our phones and maybe worry about, you know, whether we have remembered to book our Christmas event. We still have time, I hope. Or whether we have time to go for our last minute Christmas shopping. It may sound strange, but things like that happen, right? So borrowing our driven culture and language here in Singapore, maybe we can ask, no, what would your KPI be by Christmas? Instead of the merrymaking preparations, which can come and go with all the rushing, let's ask ourselves, what transformative fruits do we want to bear at the strike of midnight on Christmas? The reality is this, we all want good fruits that the Lord offers. Deep down, we also know that we need silence in our lives, as the noise around us may drown us out from what's truly necessary. We need to learn to trust that silence, though seemingly inactive or absent, is an essential ingredient to bearing good fruits. As St. Teresa of Calcutta said, the fruit of silence is prayer. The fruit of prayer is faith. The fruit of faith is love. The fruit of love is service. And the fruit of service is peace. When I was growing up, I would hear world peace as the standard response to every question and answer in any competition, whether it's beauty pageants or school competitions, no, which often became a running joke between my friends, no, for having an answer that was so generic just to gain brownie points from judges. Well, looking back in history 20 to 30 years ago, this probably made sense because of the ongoing wars that were happening then. Today, even as we ask in prayer for world peace amidst the conflicts in Europe and Middle East, what kind of peace are we asking for? The Christian peace is not just ridding of external triggers, avoiding circumstances, the absence of disturbances, or just experiencing a sort of inner tranquility. While we may experience some elements of these towards peace, they are incomplete and cannot be treated as something absolute, because they alone may hinder our personal growth. As Pope Francis explained, restlessness can be an important moment of growth in life. Many times, it is the Lord Himself who sows uneasiness in us to go to meet Him, to find Him. And at that moment, there seems to be no peace, but it is the Lord who puts us on this path to reach the peace that He Himself will give us. So peace is not confined to a venue, or feeling, or catchphrase, but it's in relation to someone close to our hearts. When we are close to someone whom we love, whether it's raining or thundering or lightning outside, no, it doesn't affect us because we feel at home and we are at peace. And tonight, Jesus offers Himself in peace and love, for He Himself loves us individually, passionately, and deeply. He says, "Come to me, all you who are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest." Jesus isn't saying that those who have been overworked or burnt out at their workplaces or at homes are invited. He's also inviting those who are carrying heavy burdens on their shoulders and hearts, regardless of their state of life or vocation they are in. The world unloads lots of burdens and baggage on us, and this can range from worries of the past and anxiety for the future. But Jesus is clear in His objective. I will give you rest, and all of you who need rest, come. He will give you the rest you need, spoken with authority and assertion. He doesn't just say these words casually, but with a voice of authority, like an anchor that settles any restlessness from the heart. Jesus continues in his pitch to win our hearts towards him. He says, "Take my yoke upon you." Now, before I continue, I have a mini confession to make here. Okay, so for many years, I've actually ignored this phrase and glanced past this. No, take my yoke upon you, and went on to read the other parts of the gospel, which are more relatable. So tonight, maybe you can join us and pause for a moment here. The yoke is a kind of a support system, actually, for the animal, where a wooden bar or frame acts as a brace, joining two animals by the neck to work and pull some weight together. This definition sounds a little dry and hard to understand, but with the help of Google Images, while preparing for tonight's guidelines, I can't help but to share the first picture that came up, showing the heads of two cows next to each other and held by this yoke. So in prayer, I understood that when Jesus says, "Take my yoke upon you," he's suggesting that the yoke was already on his neck before I come to meet him, and that he has already begun working, and all I needed was to join my load with his. Jesus doesn't get calculative with us by offering to reject us or charge us extra for having excess baggage, like how airlines would charge us if you carry too much. Instead, disregarding how much we carry, he offers this: learn from me. How? Imagine we are carrying our baggage, and next to us is Jesus, who also has baggage to carry. I'm sure we want to take a glance at what Jesus is doing to carry his baggage. We may also be tempted to see how Jesus' baggage is comparing with ours, and chances are, he's carrying the baggage of all our sorrows, worries, sins, disbeliefs, doubts, and so on. But more importantly, Jesus invites us to look at him, not at his baggage. Look at his gentleness and humility of heart, at how he continues to carry the load as his own with love dutifully, at how he chooses to take an extra effort to walk in smaller steps so that we can catch up with his pace, with the sole intention that we could walk together. Look at his decision to smile in the face of adversity, because he knows his purpose and his identity to offer love and rest to the ones who are feeling restless. And this is the sure promise of Jesus, that we will find rest for our souls through the journey of carrying our baggage, because Jesus offers a kind of peace that the world cannot give. At times, my mind will wonder, it would be so strange if Jesus spoke of peace and offered it to everyone had he not experienced it himself. So, we are journeying towards Christmas, and I would like to share this nativity scene, and maybe it can offer a perspective of Jesus' personal experience of peace. When Jesus was conceived, the womb of Mother Mary became a refuge for Jesus, even when there came a time when Mary and Joseph had to travel long distances. From the moment Jesus was born, Mary's arms provided warmth and security, transforming them into embrace, assurance, kisses, peace for our child Jesus. And I'd like to share a short moment of peace that I experienced while traveling on World Youth Day pilgrimage this year in Portugal. So our program had it that after seeing Pope Francis during World Youth Day, our group from Verbum Dei Singapore would join the rest of the Verbum Dei family all over the world for an international encounter among youths and the young at heart. So things were going well until the last day of the encounter, when the medical condition that I had recovered from had recurred. So this medical condition had something to do with the heart beating off rhythm, and according to the doctor, it could be dangerous, which I later found out that actually it could be triggered when I was exhausted or dehydrated. Two things that usually happen in trips like that. So on this particular morning, I woke up having an irregular heartbeat. It was scary at best, and paralyzing at worst. So while feeling helpless at what I could do to get better, and unsure how I could articulate my situation because it's in a different country and so on, I went down to join a group where we were led to participate in the morning prayer, hoping that in the worst case scenario, if anything happened to me, at least someone would see it. So in that morning prayer, we were invited to offer a word of hope and consolation from our prayer and share it with someone else. So being in a state of troubled mind, I started to search for a piece of paper and pen from my bag, trying to write down my prayer because articulating was hard then. I found a pen, but there was no paper with me. I left my notebook in my room. But I found a card. I found a card that was given to me by another pilgrim then. Yeah, so this was the card actually showed an abstract painting depicting a mother and an infant child. I stared at this card long and hard and began to notice that I was invited to place my trust in the peace that Mary offers with a motherly love, even when the health crisis was happening at the very same time. I forgot the exact words I wrote in the card because after writing it, I gave to my sharing partner. But it went something like, "Mom, I know what I'm going through. You know what I'm going through, and it's difficult. And I thank you for letting me share this moment with you." This story could have ended in a fairy tale manner, if my physical heart could beat back in normal rhythm immediately. Instead, what happened was this soft assurance in my ears from Jesus and Mother that they will stay with me to pull through this episode of off-rhythm period altogether, followed by tears in my eyes, which I guess was their way of moving my soul to trust in God. But God really did miracles for me that day because I noticed that this rhythm had gone away after the closing mass, which happened a few hours after this episode. We who receive Christ are ambassadors of peace. We need to recognize that ambassadors of peace are not limited to war-torn areas far away, but also to the less visible areas where there's division among our loved ones closer to home or within ourselves. Learning from Jesus and Mary, we need to turn back to the Lord, who is the source of peace, and see that we have the capacity to offer peace to our fellow brothers and sisters, whether in our families, communities, workplaces, social circles, and so on. Let us also not forget to ask for the courage to share that same peace of Christ to areas of our lives which may have been wounded or shelved in shame, because in the eyes of God, His greatest joy is to see us give Him glory with our lives. We are going to enter into a time of prayer soon, and I would like to suggest a prayer from the psalmist who says, "I will hear what the Lord God has to say, a voice that speaks of peace, peace for His people and His friends and those who turn to Him in their hearts." As we read the Word of God in the time of silence, let us be open to the words that Jesus wishes to speak to us. Let us be attentive to the tone that Jesus speaks, in the way that He wants to meet us, not just physically or mentally, but also spiritually. Let us be honest with Him, conversing with Him about our lives, our areas of doubt, and let Him reveal to us what He sees in them, and how we can carry His peace in our hearts each day. I'll be sharing the passages, and you may turn off your cameras, and we will come back about 20 minutes later.